Welcome. We'll start with the chapter 5 for NCERT class 11 geography that talks about minerals and rocks. Now we'll first understand what is a mineral and how we understand the rocks. Now this diagram helps us understand the rock and we'll find out the various minerals and the elements. To demonstrate, we have a kind of small rocks that we have taken from the ground itself. Now we have different rocks that we have here. Each of these rocks is composed of a kind of different mineral that you can see. So if you look closely onto this rock, you would see that there are various minerals that could be seen here. Now the one that is shining here is the mica. Then you have other minerals that are present. Now I have different samples for the rock that we have here. Now each of this rock is composed of a different mineral. So let's say, as you can see the shining surface with mica, we would be talking about the six basic minerals as we move forward in our lecture. So these six basic minerals, one of these is mica, which is found mostly in the electrical instruments that we use. Then you have a kind of sample rock that we have for marble. So that's a kind of foliated metamorphic rock. So it has lines or bands that you can see. Another example of lines and bands is here. So you have the bends that are seen, the black line that could be seen, which is a band. That's a kind of, again, a foliated rock. This, as we said, is a non-foliated rock. There is no specific pattern for this rock. And again, you have a kind of whole rock that is seen here, which is non-foliated. So you have two rocks that are non-foliated, you have two rocks that are foliated. We will see more as we move further. And these are some of the sample rocks that we have seen. Now as we said, each of these rocks contain various minerals. Now these minerals are made up of two or more elements or two or more compounds that could be seen. Here you have the minerals that can be seen here, that could be quartz, feldspar or biotite. Now if we take out one mineral, you have the various elements that could be seen here. So let's say quartz is a mineral which is made up of silicon and oxygen. Now on the earth crust, if we see, 98% of the earth crust is made up of 8 basic elements. These are oxygen, silicon, aluminium, iron, calcium, sodium, potassium and magnesium. Now these 8 constitute 98% of the earth's crust, and then you have the other minerals that can be seen. So this diagram and what we depicted right now helps us understand that each and every rock is made up of mineral. So in simple terms, if I want to define minerals, I can say it's a naturally occurring substance that is present and has a kind of fixed chemical and physical property, and this is known as mineral. Elements rarely occur exclusively. So it's very difficult to find silicon exclusively present in nature, very difficult to find calcium naturally present in the or exclusively present in the on the earth. So they are formed in the form of either minerals, they are present either in the form of minerals or some compounds that they are present with. Now there are few physical characteristics that help us understand the uniqueness of a mineral. So as we saw on the rocks here, each of these rocks have a external crystal form. So they have a kind of unique arrangement. So let's say the molecules are arranged in this fashion. The molecules could be arranged as a tetrahedral fashion or an octagonal fashion or so on. The next is the cleavage, that is the tendency to break. So there are two different things, cleavage and fracture. So cleavage is the tendency to break at a certain point. So let's say if I talk about igneous rocks which are layered. So you have layers of igneous rocks that could be seen. So when there is a cleavage, you have a tendency to break, and that tendency would be along the layers in which it is formed. However, when it is fracture, it is irregular breaking of the crystal. So crystal could break in any form or from anywhere, and that would be known as fracture. The next is luster. It's the appearance, whether it is metallic, it is silky, it is smooth. The next is color. Color occur mainly due to impurities present in the mineral. So a certain mineral can have certain impurity and because of which it can give a exclusive color or a unique color. Then you have stripe. Stripe means the color when it is rubbed on the ground or the surface. So when it becomes powder, what it would give. So for example, malachite is a compound of copper. It is originally green in color, but when you have a strike on the ground, it would again give green color. So it has a strike of green color. But on the other hand, you have fluorite. If you see fluorite, it is purple in color or greenish in color, but when it strikes on the ground, it gives a white color. So fluorite gives a white strike while malachite gives a green strike. So these are the differences in the strike patterns. Then the rock could be transparent, translucent or opaque in nature. So all the rocks that we have seen are opaque. The light cannot pass through them. There are some rocks which are translucent, where you have a kind of bare light that could be seen in, and transparent like glass, where you have the whole to and fro motion of the light that could be seen. Then you have the structure. Structure can be very fine. So if I take mud, I can say the arrangement would be very fine. If I take coarse grains or from the sand, if I pick up particles, those would be much more coarser or bigger in size. The hardness is measured in the Mohs scale, which varies from 1 to 10. 1 shows the softest, so you have talc, and 10 is the diamond, which shows the hardest rock. Then finally, you have the specific gravity, which shows the ratio between the weight of the object and the weight of the water that it can balance with, which is known as specific gravity. Now here we have the 6 basic minerals that are explained. The first one that are that is explained is the feldspar. Feldspar is primarily made of silica and oxygen. Along with that, you have aluminium, calcium, magnesium that is seen. Nearly half of the earth is made up of feldspar. It's the most commonly occurring mineral that is present in the earth. It's usually pink or salmon in color and mainly used for glass making and ceramic industry. The next is mica. As we said, the most of the common compounds that are seen here, the elements that are seen here are aluminium, potassium, magnesium, iron and silicon. It's mainly seen in electrical wiring, electrical instruments, and contains nearly 4% of the crust. The next is olivine. Olivine includes magnesium, iron and silicon as the predominant material. It's used in jewelry making. It's primarily green in color. The next is quartz. Quartz is made up of sand and granite. Along with that, it is usually white or colorless. It's usually used in radio and radar. It's insoluble in water. The next is pyroxene, made up of aluminium, calcium, magnesium, iron and silicon. This constitutes nearly 10% of the earth's crust that is present. It is a result of meteorites, and it is black or green in color. And finally, you have the amphiboles, which are again black or green in color. Calcium, aluminium, magnesium, iron and silicon are their main constituents, and a common example is hornblende that is seen. It is mainly used in asbestos industry. Now when we classify minerals can be classified into two: metallic and non-metallic. Non-metallic, which do not have any metal in them, like sulfur, phosphate and nitrates, and cement is an example of non-metallic mineral. When it comes to metallic, it's kind of it includes metal. This could be further classified as precious, ferrous and non-ferrous. Precious includes gold, silver and platinum. Ferrous would include iron and any compound made up of iron like steel. You have non-ferrous, which includes copper, lead, zinc, tin and aluminium. So these are the atomic names for those. The next is the rocks. Rocks, as we said, are aggregate of the minerals. Now rocks can be as soft as soapstone and as hard as granite. They could vary in color from white, which is a color of quartzite, to black of gabbro. The science to study the rock is known as petrology. Under this you study the various physical characteristics, the 10 characteristics, the luster, color, the various specific gravity and so on for the rocks. Then you have some of the most commonly found rocks, which are mainly feldspar and quartz. As we said, feldspar accounts for nearly 50% of the ocean crust, and not the ocean crust, sorry, the earth crust. And then you have the three types of rocks that are primarily understood. Those are igneous, sedimentary and metamorphic. Now, in this session, we would be focusing on these three rocks. So, let's first start with igneous rocks. Igneous rocks, as we saw, come from the volcanic activity. So, you have lava that flows out and you have the solidification of lava that takes place. As a result, you have igneous rocks that are formed. Now, igneous rocks, from the word itself, is derived from igni, that means fire. So, fire is the main constituent of the, so that's the name from which it is derived, and you have the igneous rocks. Now, if there is a very slow cooling of the lava that comes out, what would happen? The grain size would be very, very large. If it is a fast cooling that is taking place, you would have small sized grains that would be seen. So, you have the various formations from the igneous rocks. Good example of the igneous rocks would be granite, gabbro, then you have basalt, tuff and breca. So, these are some of the common igneous rocks. Now, coming on to the next rock, that is sedimentary rock. Sedimentary rock is derived from the name sedimentum, that means settling down. So, it is a result of the exogenous processes that are occurring. And when we say sedimentary rock, you have the various denudational processes, the river processes that help in erosion, and finally you have the rock formation that occurs. Now, these rocks are deposited by the process of compaction, so that is known as lithification. So, lithification is the process by which you have the sedimentary rocks which are deposited. Now, these rocks, as we talked about previously, occur in layers like soapstone, limestone. So, all these are sedimentary rocks. Sedimentary rocks can further be classified into three types. You have the mechanical rocks, which are formed as a result of mechanical action. You have the organic rock, and finally the chemical rock, or the chemically weathered sedimentary rock. The example of chemical, a good example that is applicable to all three would be limestone. So, it is a result of mechanical, organic and chemical action. Now, if we talk exclusively about chemical, you would have limestone, halite, potash and chert as a common example. Under organic rocks, you would have chalk, coal, limestone. Under mechanical rocks, you would have again limestone, sandstone, shale and loess are some of the examples. Now, the next comes is the metamorphic rock. Now, when we talk about metamorphic rock, a good term to remember this is PVT. That means pressure, volume and temperature. So, what is modified under metamorphic rock is you have more pressure that is exerted, you have the volume that changes and the it is exerted under changes in the temperature. So, if igneous rock or metamorphic rock igneous or sedimentary rock is exerted with high pressure or temperature, there would be change in the structure and the formation, and it would lead to the formation of metamorphic rock. Now, metamorphic rock, there are two basic things that are common. First is the recrystallization that occur, and finally you have the reorganization. So, recrystallization and reorganization are two inbuilt or important processes under metamorphic rock. When we say metamorphic rock, I can explain metamorphic under two heads. You have the dynamic metamorphic processes and the thermal metamorphic processes. Thermal, as the name suggests, is due to heat. So, you have thermal metamorphic due to action of heat. When I say dynamic, you have changes in the metamorphic rock composition. This can be due to heat, this can be due to any chemical action or heat or any other reason, but it is predominantly without any change in the chemical composition. Now again, metamorphic rock can be classified into two types, the foliated rocks and the non-foliated rocks. Under foliated rocks, we can have the lineage, that is the lines. So, you call it lineation or lineage, and the next is banding or the bands. So, these are the common things that are seen under foliated rocks, and then you have the non-foliated rocks that are seen. So, as we saw in the rocks, you have the band that is occurring, and you have the various lines that could be seen in a marble rock. So these are examples of foliated rock, and you have non-foliated rock. Again, when we explain metamorphic rock, there are two other heads under which we could classify it. It is contact metamorphism and regional metamorphism. Contact metamorphism occurs when magma occurs and there is high temperature that is seen. So it is a kind of new material is added to it under contact metamorphism. Under regional metamorphism, there is a kind of subduction or recrystallization that occurs. It occurs with high temperature and pressure, which is commonly seen with a kind of tectonic shearing activity that could be seen. Common example of metamorphic rocks are granite, schist, slate, and so on. Now, this diagram helps us understand the rock cycle. So, what happens to the rock initially? You have the magma that solidifies and crystallizes to form the igneous rock. This igneous rock undergoes various weathering and erosional processes and is carried away by the process of subduction to form sediments. The sediments finally lithify, and there is compaction and cementation that occurs, leading to the formation of sedimentary rock. Sedimentary rock under high pressure and temperature would again form the metamorphic rock. That would be the process of metamorphism. And when the sedimentary rock is eroded, it would form the sediments again. Igneous rock again would either melt and form the magma back, or it would under high pressure and temperature form the metamorphic rock. This metamorphic rock, which under high temperature would again melt to form the magma. So there is a kind of circulation that goes on in the system, and there is one rock form that changes into another rock form with time, and you have the rock cycle that comes up. With this, we cover the chapter 5. We'll be covering more lectures in geography in the upcoming sessions. You can subscribe to our lecture for further updates. Have a good day ahead.